Hello, and happy Saturday. Anyone out there watching data science? Welcome to my stream for Saturday, January 30th. If you're an animal, an alien, or an elf, or actually a human who's interested in data, my name is Carl, and I'm a data scientist in Silicon Valley, California. First thing, let me ask if anyone's out on the chat is, how's the music volume? It kind of fluctuates a little bit. I use a Spotify stream. I think sometimes it changes the level on me, because I swear I don't mess with it, and sometimes it's too loud or too soft, so let me know. Anyway, today is a very special stream for me because it's actually one of my favorite subjects, which is feature engineering to make great customer metrics. So that's what I'm gonna do. I'll dive right in. For those of you who haven't seen my streams before, I do play music, as you're hearing. It's copyright-free music on Spotify. I also spend a while talking at the beginning of my stream because I try to explain the background in the area of data science, which I'm going to be talking about. But we are going to do SQL and Python coding in just a few minutes, so bear with me if you've already seen my streams before. I don't know. Sometime I should like do a poll and see, do you want me to do the basic stuff or do you want me to go right to the new material? But let me get on with it. So what is churn? That's the most basic thing I have to explain. Churn is when customers or users quit from a stream or from a product or service. It applies to all products with recurring revenue, could be a paid subscription, in-app purchase, or ad supported. And it comes from something called the churn rate, which is the percentage of people that quit the service in a given time period, day, month, or year. Churn is also now a verb. It's come in such wide use. You can say the customer churned, or even I'm churning because there's nothing good to watch on Netflix anymore. I'm going to read more books this year. It's my New Year's resolution, something like that. It's also a noun. You can say make a churn report. You know, tell me all the churns from last quarter. So that's kind of the churn lingo when you're in the business. So why learn about churn? I say, it's the most common data science problem today because every company has a churn problem, but you need special techniques to handle churn. It's not typical in many respects. This is also a great way to learn data science foundations because on my stream, I go from raw data all the way to usable results for a company or business. So what was Fighting Churn with Data? On my first slide, that's a book I wrote. It's out now. It's based on my experience as a chief data scientist at a company called Zora. I'll tell you about that in a sec. And there's a discount coupon here, discount code 40% off if you want to get the book at my publisher's website. Or if you have Amazon, you can get it there, free shipping and whatnot. You know, we all face those tough trade-offs between free shipping and, discount codes or supporting other companies other than Amazon. I had a tough decision today. I was like, should I buy Barnes & Noble for a dollar more or Amazon? I'm not going to tell you what I did. I think it was more than a dollar more, actually. Anyway, so what was Zora? Zora is a company where I work, and it's a platform for subscription companies. So many companies that you've heard of use Zora, including Zoom, the video company, which is now also a noun and a verb. So Zoom manages their customers and many aspects of their product on Zora, as do many companies. So that's how I came to do so much work on churn analysis. As Zora's data scientist, I was working with lots of companies, so I sort of got so much into churn that I decided to write a book about it. Fool that I am. What was I thinking? Anyway, so what is fighting churn with data really mean is data-driven churn reduction, which is the goal of everything you do with data for churn, because it's not an academic exercise. You want to improve your product, reach out to your customers, give them support and the love that they need at the right times in their customer journey, and also have a good pricing plan so you get value from your customers and to your customers, but without discounting, because fighting churn is not really about giving out discounts. Despite what, you know, some companies do, that's not a good practice to give discounts when people churn. Whew, I think I'm done with that. We can finally look at some data. Yay. Also, this is the same data if you've already seen the stream before, but what is the data for fighting churn? I have to show people who've never seen it before. I have a schema here in Postgres. Whoops. Social net. I'll tell you how you can get this data in just a sec, but we have subscription data in this database. So you can see here each subscription has a start date and an end date. It's for one account. These are actually what we call co-term subscriptions because the end date of one lines up with the start date of the next. So account one here has all these subscriptions, and I guess account one churns on June 29th, looks like, because that's the end of their subscriptions. So we use this data to figure out who's signed up and who's churned. And then we've also got other data on the things that customers do on the service, which is event and metric data. I have a query lined up here for the event data, it looks like, except I'm going to need to set the schema first, or the search path. I forget what you call it. Postgres, MySQL, different database systems, it's all kind of a blur for me. Kind of like Python and R also. I'll forget like which language I'm supposed to be working in. But anyway, that set the schema, and now this is a sample of the event data from the service. So each event has a time and a type, and there's a type table. I won't go into the details. So this is event data for a social network. It's actually not a real social network. It's a simulated social network that you can use for learning about churn. And there's information about it on my GitHub repo, which I'll give in just a sec. But first, let me tell you, these events are things like liking posts, viewing ads. You can see ad view. There's also messages, and all the events are also for specific times and accounts, which is something you need to use the data to fight churn. You need to actually be able to track your customers as they use your product or service, and that way you can correlate the behavior back to their subscriptions and whether they renew or churn. I mean, because churn is the opposite of renewing. All right, so that is what the basic data looks like. But in let me see, I think the next thing I've got to show you is where to get the data. If you haven't seen that, I have a GitHub repo where you can download the repo, obviously. You will need Postgres and Python set up. There's instructions in my README for a basic setup, which will work for most people. And then there's a data simulation, which will give you the data that looks like what I was just showing you, those events and subscriptions that you can then use to analyze churn. So let's get into some churn analysis. Let's see. This is an overview of the data set. So in an earlier stream, we made a data set. You could look that up in an earlier stream to watch me make the data set. I mean, I can show you the data set right here. If you've never seen a data set before, you can see it in an Excel spreadsheet. This is a basic data set. There's one column for the account ID. So each row of the data set is for one account. Each row in the data set has a date that it's an observation for, and also there's an outcome of whether or not the customer churned, which is the outcome or the dependent variable if you speak statistics speak about how to describe these things. Then the other columns are metrics, which have already been calculated from the events. I kind of skipped a step on you, but also this is in other streams and in the book that I wrote. How you go from events to metrics is very important. And actually, today's stream, we're going to talk more about creating metrics like these ones. So these are basic metrics, like per month, new friend per month, post per month. These are the things that the customers do on the service, and the metrics summarize them at the time when the customer decided to renew or churn. So that's kind of like the foundation of all this. And if you can make a data set like this by other means, then you can use all the techniques that I'm going to use going forward. Or if you don't have a data set yet, you can follow the techniques in the book, but I'm not going to do the data set creation today. What back here, I was showing you an overview of the statistics of the data set. This first variable shows you the churn rate. So it's about a 4% churn rate in this social network. The likes per month are average 95 for each customer. But there's some really extreme customers who like things thousands of times. They must spend a lot of time on social networking. It's maybe not that realistic, but like I said, this is a simulation. It's not completely real data. There's these other metrics like the number of new friends, posts per month, ad view per month, dislike per month, etc. So I don't think also I'm going to talk about how we do these statistics. When it says listing on one of these things I'm showing you, it means that's where it is in the book. So 5.2 means it's the second listing in chapter 5. And we'll look at some of the code in like just a minute. I'm almost done with all the intro. And I need to like drink something from my throat. So I'm almost done with all the intro. And then we can get on to some new coding and data science very, very soon. So we're going to talk about behavior and churn and what customers do that makes them churn or not churn. That's really the theme of a lot of this, and we're in the thick of it in this stream. I'm not going to use regression and machine learning, which are the standard tools of a data scientist, of course, but right now we're just going to do some thinking work with visualization and analytics, because you can test all the theories that you want, I think, just using visualizations. And if you have a really strong result in your data, you'll see it with a visualization very clearly, and you don't need statistics or machine learning to prove it. Later on, after you've proved out a bunch of hypotheses about the customers, we'll use regression and machine learning to do others, you know, to do more advanced stuff. But this is still like the foundation. And this is my favorite quote by a scientist. If you need to use statistics to understand your experiment, you ought to have done a better experiment. That was said more than 100 years ago. Wow. Time flies. All right. So how do we understand churn without using equations and statistics? You can do visualizations like this one, which shows you the churn rate for different customers using a product called Clipfolio. Clipfolio are some good friends of mine. They were customers at Zora. I should tell them about this stream now that you mention it. I wonder if I could get some of those guys up here to chat on the stream. Anyway, these are metric cohorts. So you form cohorts from the customers by grouping them when they have similar value on the metric. So all the top customers on the metric go in the top cohort, shown here, and they have the lowest churn rate. And they have the highest, this is the clip edits per month for the Clipfolio editor. And then the fewest edits per month have the highest churn rate. Now, the churn rate is on the y-axis, but I'm not showing you the churn rate because this is private sensitive data for Clipfolio. They allowed me to show this to you for the case study, but not to actually know about their churn rate. I've got a few more examples here. These are all Zora customers. This is Broadly. Broadly is an app used by small businesses to manage their online reviews. And this is showing that the more review updates per month on Broadly, the lower the churn rate, about 50% reduction in churn rate for people above 4 review updates per month. And one more example, churn study originated with telco, and Versature is a telco that I worked with. Well, they're voice over IP. So they provide online telecommunication services, and this shows that the calls per month is also very strongly related to churn for people on the Versature telecommunication service. And all these churn cohorts kind of have this same shape where churn is reduced, and then there's like an elbow, or you know, then you kind of hit the valley in your churn rate, and further improvement doesn't make too much difference. So I say all these cohorts, they do kind of look the same, actually, when your data is good. So if you have clean data for any product or service, you should be able to form cohort charts, and they should look roughly like these. There is definitely some variability that we'll see. But yeah, if it looks very different from this, then something's probably wrong, or you're looking at the wrong events or metrics. Okay, I think we can look at some code for this. Let's do a quick metric cohort for anyone who hasn't seen it, I guess. We'll do more of these soon, but I haven't gotten into any code yet. So let's just do this. If you've all seen this before, people can like shout out in the chat and say, get to new stuff. But to do a metric cohort, I go to listing 5.1, which is chapter 5, listing 1 from Fighting Churn with Data. And I've already got a breakpoint here, I think I've already got a configuration set up to run this. Yeah, I have all these things set up because I did this in previous streams. So I'll just do a quick example and we'll look at more code soon. So first, I'm gonna hit run and stop at the breakpoint. So the first thing we do, this is the Python function that's going to do one of those metric cohort plots that we just looked at. The first thing is to check if the file is good, so that you pass in a path to the data. And in this case, it's good because I've used it before. You load the data into a data frame, and then you actually use this qcut function from pandas. I should mention data frames are also from pandas. So let's import the pandas library here. The qcut function stands for quantile discretization, which is essentially dividing the data into discrete groups. That's the discrete part in the name. And quantile means it's based on the quantiles, like the deciles. So the default is to do 10 deciles. So this actually divides the data into the groups, but the groups is a series variable. It means it's an indicator for each point in the data which group it's in. The next row actually calculates the average value of the metric in each group by using the group by function on the data frame and passing in the groups function. If anyone has any questions, comments, feel free to jump in on the chat. Chat's been quiet today. Don't know what's going on out there, but I'll just keep explaining this for anyone who hasn't heard it. The next line actually determines the churn rate, which is determined by just using the mean of a group by on the groups. But this time we use the churn indicator column. And that's it. That's actually the cohort analysis right here. And you can see the result in this. I made a new data frame that has the result of the cohort analysis for convenience. So this is the average post per month, and then this is the average churn rate. And with the highlighting heat map colors, you can actually see that they go in opposite directions. So more posts per month, lower churn. And I'm just gonna let, the rest of this is plotting with matplotlib. I think I'm gonna skip this and get on to some new code examples. Or actually, I'm gonna show you the results of this back out in the slide deck. This is the results of you doing these cohorts on the simulation data. So this is not real data now. The last examples were real data from real case studies. And this is the simulation, which really looks a lot like the real data in that the most likes per month has the lowest churn rate and the fewest has the highest churn rate. Now you can actually see what the churn rates are because this is not private or sensitive data. So you can see in this case, the average churn rate, remember, was 4% from that descriptive statistics. Hey, Scott, welcome back. Glad you have time on a Saturday afternoon to hang out with me and do data. I heard you guys had heavy rain down in Los Angeles this week. We had it up here, or kind of missed us actually. It was weird. It was raining all over California, but we didn't get it too heavy in the Bay Area. I heard they got dumped in the mountains. Anyway, that's a good dump. I mean, dumped in snow. So here's more cohorts from the simulation data. Here's an interesting one. This is ad views per month. So you might think that viewing a lot of ads would piss people off and they would churn. But this makes it look like the more ads they view, the less they churn. And we're going to return to this in just a few moments when we do new stuff. Same for dislikes per month. You're kind of like, if you dislike a lot of stuff on a social network, if the social network even has dislikes, you might think you would churn, but these people seem to churn more, the more they dislike. It's always saying it backwards. This is unfriending per month. Anyway, these are the other cohorts from the data. Let me just go through these. This one is actually for account tenure, which is how long customers have been a customer, which is another important kind of cohort analysis in the length of time for a customer. But let's get through all this. Last week, we were talking about the relationship between behaviors. And when I say what I'm talking about last week, it means I'm finally almost up to new material for all of those who have been patiently waiting for me to talk about something new. Thank you for your patience. So last week, we looked at correlation, and we talked about merging highly correlated metrics as averages and using normalized metrics, which we're actually going to talk about something using that today too. We also looked at using loading matrices and hierarchical clustering. Whoops. Well, didn't mean to go into last week so much, but this was all last week. I'm not even sure why I have this here. I'm not sure we really need these concepts for today. Today, let's just talk about today. We don't need the correlation so much. We're going to talk about advanced behavior measurement, or what I call advanced behavior measurements, using ratio metrics, which is hands down my favorite feature engineering or metric measuring technique. So we're going to start with a motivating example, which hopefully you haven't seen before. Then we're actually going to do the code, and then we're going to look at more examples, and then we're going to look at another kind of ratio metric, which is percent of total. So we're going to look at variations on the theme for the rest of the stream, and that's the plan. And then we're going to talk about it. And actually, yeah, if anyone wants at the end, I thought of some good live hacking stuff that I could do. But let's get started with a motivating example for using advanced metrics to understand behavior. The motivating example is this. Think about revenue and churn. Revenue meaning how much money you, the business, take in from your customer. And you ask yourself, do people who pay more churn more? Anyone on the chat, do you know, do people who pay more churn more, or do people who pay more churn less? And you can say it if you've already seen this before. If you've actually seen me talking at a conference, you probably saw this example already. But anyway, this is revenue and churn for Versature, the telco, and it shows that the more someone pays, the less they churn, because this churn rate plot goes down. This is a normalized metric. Might be kind of hard to see that small font, actually. But this is a normalized metric for the amount their customers pay. And you can see clearly that the customers who pay the least, top left, churn the most, roughly double or more than double the higher paying customers down here. Now, I probably didn't wait long enough for anyone in the chat to even respond to that, because I've noticed when I type in the chat on other people's streams, there's like a delayed reaction. But anyway, so people who pay more usually churn less, which is kind of weird if you were thinking about it and expecting them to churn more. And one thing about people who pay more is usually they have more money. That's why they've been paying you more. They signed up for a more expensive plan. So their credit card tends to not fail, which is, you know, one reason they churn less. But it does not entirely explain why people who pay more churn less. It's not just because they have more money and their credit card doesn't fail. Yes, I finally saw Scott's reply, pay more, churn less. I knew someone would say that, but it would take like 5 minutes for Twitch to get it to me. It probably wasn't 5 minutes, but it seemed like 5 minutes. It was probably more like 3 minutes. But anyway, yep, pay more, churn less. Now, let's look more about why. One reason people who pay more churn less is they usually use the product more. This is also for Versature. And on the, on the y-axis is the amount they pay, again, as a normalized score. And on the x-axis is the amount of calls they make as a normalized score also. And you can see a pretty high correlation between the two variables. You know what? This is why I included a note about correlation in the beginning of the stream. I guess I was planning this out. Yes, don't assume causality. Exactly. This is correlation. It's not causation. Scott already jumped ahead and threw out the answer. So this is what the correlation is too. So this is one of those churn cohorts again. This is for the normalized metric of the number of calls. And this also shows why you'd normalize the metric, so it's a straight line in your chart. But the more calls, the less churn. The more they pay, the more calls. So that's why the more they pay, the less churn. And Scott also is coming out with all the answers. Thank you, Scott. Raising pricing doesn't reduce churn. No, definitely not. It's really like a selection bias. When you look at your highest paying customers, those are your customers who use the service the most. But raising the prices won't actually reduce churn. Now, in fact, it will increase churn, because that's what we're going to see in the advanced metric, which is the next slide. So the advanced metric here, and I'm just gonna show you the answer of how to do this, is with dollars per call. So before we were looking at dollars per month and calls per month. So now I'm saying, let's look at dollars per call. So again, this is still continuing the Versature example, although I'm kind of blocking their logo. Sorry, Versature. Blocking your logo a little bit. So this is the chart for churn versus the MRR, which is monthly payments. You divide monthly payments by monthly calls. This was the chart for calls per month. And if you do the churn cohort of, you get a metric called dollars per call. And then lo and behold, the more people pay per call, the more they churn. We just completely flipped the direction of the cohort chart. So now the bottom cohort with the lowest dollars per call churns the least. And actually several of the bottom cohorts, like the first five or so cohorts, in fact, all of the below average cohorts, because this is normalized, so zero is the mean. So all of the below average cohorts have pretty low churn, and the few cohorts that are above average have very high churn. So that's how you see that raising prices will cause people to churn, because you will increase the dollars per call that people have to pay to use your service. Well, most likely it'll raise a churn, raise their churn. If you just raise the prices a little bit, maybe you can get away with it. Or if your customers don't have a better alternative, they don't, you know, their high switching cost for your service, you might also get away with raising prices. But raising prices does not cause people to not churn. It would cause people to churn by raising their dollars per call. So this is an example of why you use a ratio metric, because it separates out the correlation and causation for a lot of important use cases and customer data, and it does it in a way that's really easy to interpret. So let's see. This is the motivating example from the Versature case study. Now here's a I think the next thing to look at is the motivating example from the simulation case study. So here's the simulation motivating example. Remember we said ad views, why does that reduce churn? That's kind of weird. This was the churn rate versus ad views from the simulation. Then you've got posting, which really reduces churn. Now we wanted to know, are they correlated? I actually haven't done this example, so I was gonna do a quick example of making one of those scatter plots to round out the prep. So now we're doing our real case study. This is like, put on our data scientist hat, and we're like, why does ad views look like it reduces churn? I wonder if it's related to posts. We'll dive in and look at metric pair plots, which was listing 6.1, and I have to figure out the right version. So this will be listing 6.1 metric pair plot. And I want to do ad views and post correlation. And I don't, it's in my configuration for this somewhere. So let's see. This is a JSON configuration controlling all the listings that are run for the book. And I have to figure out what chapter I'm in. All right, I am in chapter 6 because I was doing chapter 6 last week. Listing 1. I want post per month and ad views per month. And maybe this is it. Yeah, okay, version 7. So if I do this, I might have been doing this already. Let's check. No, this is chapter 5, listing 1. Oh no, chapter 6, listing 1. All right, I'm gonna add a version. This is the configuration for running listings from the book. There's basically a program that comes with a book that makes it easy to run the chapter examples. I hope it's easy. If anyone's ever used it, is easy. Oh, hey, Maddie. Ooh, wow, a raiding party from Maddie Two Chooses channel. Welcome. Nice to have you guys with me. How'd your stream wrap up? I hope it was good. And it's getting pretty late for you, I know. So thank you for staying up to raid on over here. And how many people are watching data science in the middle of the night or like at 10 p.m. in Europe? I'm curious. I guess in the pandemic, so it was version 7. I'm getting distracted. I was supposed to do version 7. I guess in the pandemic, some people might be doing data science on a Saturday night because there's nothing else to do. All right, I was going to do a quick metric pair plot, and I can show that real quick. Hopefully, it'll be the right one. Oh, hey, Lily. Glad for you. Glad you're sticking with me here. Nice. So you learned a lot of SQL. Yeah, I have something of a following. I don't know. I'm not a Twitch star, but my kids are really nice. When I tell them that, like, oh, I have like 300 followers, they're like, oh, that's great. My favorite streamer has 5 million followers, and I'm like, wow. That's why video games are more popular. Video games are just more popular than data science. Yep, gotta start somewhere. All right, so this is doing the metric pair plots. This also really relies on pandas. So I load the data into a pandas data frame easily. We saw that before. I select out the two series of metrics that I want to analyze. And I think, let's see, metric one, I hope it's post per month. Yeah, metric two should be ad view per month. All right, we're good on the parameters. Measure the correlation, it's 0.54. I showed how to do all this in a previous stream, so I'm kind of just going to go straight through this. And then we do a scatter plot, and let me find it on my drive. Oops, I don't think I prepared that today. Let's see, go to the output directory, and we will see... Sorry, I didn't really have this set up here. Let's see. So we just made a metric pair plot for these two metrics. And they look moderately correlated. Not as highly correlated as that other example we were looking at before. Correlation 0.54. And this is post per month versus ad views per month. There's another trick to do here, which is to look at the correlation between the metric as scores. And then they're sometimes more correlated. So I'm going to try that too. And I think there's already a configuration for that as well. Or actually, I could hack it real quick. Yeah, if I just copy this dataset path here and put it into this configuration, then I can just run the same one again. This time I won't debug it. Oh wait, algebra, 97, got, oh yeah, talking about, wow, I'm missing the chat. Everyone would love to be raided by Pokemon. Hey, glad to see all the data science people on Twitch I know are getting together. So Algebra 97, Maddie Two Shoes, Lily Sue, these are the data science posse. So let me quickly do this example to give you guys something new to look at while you're chatting. Let's see. This is the correlation of those metrics as scores. Now this is, here you go, perfect example. This is the correlation, come on, get over there. My window's not behaving. So you can see that when you've converted these metrics to normalized scores, you actually have a noticeably higher correlation. 0.54 on their natural scale, 0.66 after you've converted them to normalized scores. Also, you get these weird, discrete levels in the scores. It's kind of common, actually. These are the low values, like 0, 1, 2. I talked about that on another stream. But anyway, this answers our question that posts per month and ad views per month are indeed correlated. And that is probably going to explain why we were seeing that ad views per month reduces churn. So how are we going to do this? Now we're going to calculate the ratio metric. This is the new part. How do you calculate a ratio metric? It's actually dead simple. You just take the ratio of one metric to another. So it's literally a ratio of two metrics. Here's a toy example here. If you have account one has 75 ad views on a certain date and 60 posts, you literally divide 75 by 60 and you get ad views per post, 1.25. And if account three has 90 and 110, et cetera, et cetera. You get the idea, I hope. But I'm gonna show you this in SQL in just a sec, because we're not gonna calculate that. We're gonna calculate this efficiently for a whole bunch of customers and a whole bunch of dates in one fell swoop by using a SQL. So let's do it. That is listing 7.1, the ratio metric query. Let's see, what do I need to do? I need to maybe open it. I won't set a breakpoint, I can't, because this is actually a sequel, but we can look quickly. Yes, the power of sequel compels you. but we'll look at how you look at how to do this metric first, and then I'll just run it and look at some examples. Actually, Scott, I don't use normalized scores for when I calculate the metric, and a very good point, actually. I use the unnormalized metric because then you get an interpretable unit, which is like ad views per post or dollars per call. And then later on, after I've taken the ratio metric, I'll turn it into a normalized score. But I first do it in the unnormalized metric. Also, that's what we've got in the database. So to do the calculation I just showed you with a SQL, we have one common table expression here that selects the metric time, the value from one table, from the metric table, and we use a bind variable to set the metric name. If you haven't seen this before, this is kind of common in Python Postgres to indicate a variable that you're gonna substitute for with a percent. Pretty good music on this channel, have to say. After this, I have to look and see who this was. Take me away, Stonebank and Emil. Gotta look those guys up later. Anyway, we also will select the metric over a range of dates and do exactly the same thing for the denominator. So then I've got the numerator and the denominator. I'm gonna save this metric into the database. So as an into the metric table with an insert statement. And then this is the ratio calculation. There's a little bit of a subtlety here, or not subtlety, but a little bit of a complication. How should I describe it? You don't want to do a divide by zero. So if you have to make a case to check if the denominator is greater than zero, then you can divide the numerator by the denominator. I'll explain this coalesce in a second. Otherwise, I'm just returning zero for the ratio value. The coalesce is in case the numerator is missing, because a lot of these metrics are counts, like ad views per month. And if there's no, I don't store zeros in the database. That's a data saving or a space saving issue, which is important if you have rare metrics. You don't want to fill up your database with zeros. So here I coalesce. If there was no metric, coalesce statement fills in the second result. So if there's no value for the numerator, I fill in with the zero. No value means null. So actually, when I join the denominator and the numerator, I use a left outer join. More important SQL points here. The left outer join means there's a result whenever you have a denominator. And the numerator can actually be missing, in which case you get a null. But I'm catching that up here in my coalesce statement. And that's mostly it. So of course we're joining on account ID and metric time. Yeah, basically when X equals null, then zero, but faster. I actually don't know if it's faster. This is just a Postgres thing to use the coalesce statement. Is it standard SQL or not? I don't even know, but I got used to using it. And performance on SQL, don't ask me, because I'm not a database guru. Oh yeah, well definitely not storing zeros in the metric table is less bytes to store. And you'd think it wouldn't make a difference if you look at if you've got a data set like the one I've got in the simulation where there aren't that many zeros, it actually doesn't matter. But I've definitely seen, coalesce is standard SQL. But anyway, I've definitely seen cases where events are very rare for the customers. And if you have rare events and you store your zeros, you're just gonna fill up your database with zeros, or your data warehouse. And that's just kind of stupid. Even with all the hardware, we can throw out problems today. Also in T-SQL. What is T-SQL actually? I'm trying to think. T. All right, you guys will let me know what T-SQL is in a minute. Anyway, I think I have fully beat to death this query, as long as no one has any questions about it. Transact SQL, Microsoft's. I know what Microsoft is. So I'm gonna run this example version. I have actually an example version of the ratio metric from the book where I print out the numerator value and the denominator value and the metric value. Let's run that one first. I need to make a new configuration for the book to do it here. Whoops. Make a new configuration, which I do just by duplicating. So this is going to be my 7-1 configuration. And I'm going to get rid of this version parameter and do just chapter 7 listing 1. And I guess I'll move this up to the top because I'm going to be using that. All right, so no debugging here. This is just going to run the SQL against the database, hopefully. Haven't run a SQL for a while, and it prints it out. Okay, so the program will actually insert these date values. It inserted the names AdView per month and Post per month from the the configuration that was in that JSON file, and these dates are also in the configuration. And okay, and here's the SQL result. So this is just a toy calculation, like I said, that it shows for each account the numerator value 22, the denominator value, and then what the resulting metric is. So we can see from this simple example that ad views for post per post tend to be low, less than 1. Now this is just a printout example, and I have these in the book to illustrate the result. That's what this is, an illustration. And then in the book, there's another version of the query, which is the one I was showing you, which was before, which is the insert. This is the insert version that has the insert statements, and it doesn't show you the details of the numerator and the denominator and stuff. So now let's run the insert version, which is really just run the same way. I'm gonna make like another duplicate of this one. I'll call this insert. And I just add this argument. I did this kind of special thing in chapter 7. I made a special argument of the book because for every SQL, I wanted a kind of interpretable illustration, and then also the one that will actually save the result. Now this might run a little bit longer because this is gonna actually insert it into the database, hopefully. So now I'm actually doing my insert into the metric table. Although ratio metrics actually calculate pretty quick, faster than the underlying metrics, because the underlying metrics for things like ad views per post or ad views per month, it has to count all the ad views. This only has to join two tables and insert the result. So here now I've inserted the results, and I'm just wondering, what do I do about the name? I think I've also got the name. This is the metric name insert, is also done in the same query here. There's a table that lists the name. So now this should actually be in my database. And I'm just going to do a quick check, a sanity check in the database. Let's see, select count. Well, first let's select star from metric name. I want to confirm my metric name result, but I have a new one. Down here, ooh, I messed it up. Add the per post. Oh well, I'm not gonna fix that now. So I've got a new result in the metric name table. I wanna do a quick select from the metric table itself to make sure I had a result. From metric, where metric, I think it's like a name ID equals 21. This will be the count of my new metric in the table, which is, all right, well, it looks like a lot, 121,000. So there's definitely some results. So something worked. The query actually saved results. Now, how am I going to do my analysis? Let me actually need to back up and explain a little bit. Okay, first, this is actually a slide explaining what I just showed you, that in the Fighting Churn With Data program to run this stuff, you add the insert flag in chapter 7 to save to the database. Without the insert flag, it's going to print out the result, which is kind of for the interpretability and just when you're learning what the query does. Then we have to re-extract the data set to do our analysis, because the churn cohort analysis that we looked at before depends on an extracted data set from the database. So let's see. I already actually did this. I went out of order. I did listing 7.1, the insert version. Now I have to do the dataset 2 SQL, which is going to add the new metric to the dataset, and I'll show that. And then we can redo the metric cohorts on the new metric. So that's the game plan now. And this is pretty much what you do, as I do in a case study. As I'm adding new metrics, I'll try a new metric, then add it to the data set, extract the data set, look at the result. It's kind of an iterative cycle, unfortunately. So let's see, I want to do the data set SQL. And this is all, was explained really fully in a previous stream also. Where is my data set to? Here it is, listing 7.2. So I went into this in a lot of detail in an earlier stream, so I don't want to beat it to death now. But this is a great SQL trick for everyone who loves SQL tricks. This is how you take data in a table of metrics and turn it into a data set. What you need to do is separate each metric into its own column, and that's what this case statement does. So the first column is going to be for the like per month metric, and it's got metric name ID 0. So in this case statement, you only select that value, otherwise 0. And by wrapping it in a sum and grouping by a count ID, you end up with the right format for a data set, which is one row per account, one column per metric. And I haven't run this for a while, but hopefully it'll work. Somewhere down here, I've got my new metric, add view per post, which was metric ID 21. So this is an update to the data set. Earlier chapters of the book had a simpler data set. This also has a bunch of other new metrics, which we're gonna add little by little by going through the next examples. So I'm just gonna set this up and run it, because I really did beat it to death in a previous stream. Wow, I named all my configurations run cohorts. I really haven't been like updating that enough. I need to fix that. Dataset, which is 7.2. Oh, really? You did that in the DataCamp course? That's cool. DataCamp must be a quality course if they're teaching that trick. What do they call it in DataCamp? I call it the data flattening trick, for lack of a better name. But is there an official name for that trick? That would actually be nice. Let's see. So I'm going to run this dataset SQL. Again, no debugging. It's just going to run it. And this should actually save the result. Well, it'll show us the SQL here with any bind variables filled in. I guess there might be like a date bind, a few date bind variables set here at the top. And this one runs pretty quick too. And this just saves the results to a file. So now I have my first iteration of dataset 2, which has the new metric, or it should have the new metric. So let's actually take a look and make sure it has the new metric. This is my new dataset file. I generally just double click on these files and open them up in Excel. This is the old dataset, actually. Don't look at that. Remember, we looked at the old dataset before. Here is the new data set. It always opens in my other window for whatever reason. Now the new data set, which I will enlarge, has the new metric in this column, add view per post, if that's even visible in the small font. Let me actually zoom in and we can freeze columns here. It's usually the best way to look at these things in Excel. And now you can see, if I scroll over, so anyway, we have the new add view per post column in the data set. All these other columns are still blank. So this is basically just me confirming success. I calculated a new metric, inserted it to the database, re-extracted it into my data set, and now I have this in a column. You know, usually a good thing to do at this point is to check the statistics of the new metric. So let's do that real quick too. That would be in DataCamp they didn't have a name. They refer to it as sum of logical values that are for computer. That is not a name. My name is better. The data flattening trick. So I'm going to stick with my name. Let's see. So what was I doing? I was going to quickly check the statistics of the new data set, which is listing 5-2. And let's see. I need to edit my configurations. Actually, you know, I need to figure out which configuration to use. Because in the configuration JSON, I know there's a version that will do dataset 2 statistics, which will be version 2 on listing 5.1. So I'm going to go, or listing 5.2. I'm going to go back to listing 5.2 and do version 2, which will give us the summary statistics for the new metric. Wait, no, that's the wrong one. Sorry, it is. It probably is the right one. Yeah, it is the right one. All right, so let's. Oh God, this. Now that I see that I have the wrong name for these, I can't not see it. Run stats. I should just say stats. Wasn't really paying attention to those descriptive names, just the numbers. Anyway, this will do a quick run of summary stats on the data set. I'm not going to show the code for that because, well, as with everything, I've done it in a previous stream. But I do want to show you the stats of the new metric. Let's see, did it work? This is actually like another sanity check. I don't think it worked. All right, I entered the wrong configuration or something because I don't see add view per post as one of my metrics, and I should if this worked. Again, more sanity. You can do much shorter in R or Python. Yeah, I'm not even sure how you do that in R or Python because I always just do it in SQL. Now, why did I run the wrong version of dataset stats? Oh, version 2 was the score dataset. That was the wrong version of the set. I need dataset 2 is what I need here. I need the version which is for dataset 2. Come on, I have too many versions. In the book, I list would. Don't worry, if you follow along with the book, you won't be doing this, because in the book, I always tell you the right one to use. I'm going to do a search for data set 2, which is version, what? Looks like it's version 10, or what the hell? I'm going to hack this in a second. This is going to be a waste of time. Oh, it's actually version 1 all along. Facepalm, sorry everyone, I've been taking so long on this. All we wanted to do was see what. I should have practiced this in advance, so thank you for bearing with me. Let's see the stats that actually have the new metric, hopefully. All right, yes, this looks more like it. So, finally, we can see the statistics of ad view per post along with the other ones in our data set. So the first column, or the first, is the name, and this is the row for our ad view per post metric. So 97% of customers have a value for that. That's what this column means. These are the percent of customers that actually have that metric. 97% for ad view per post. The average ad views per post is 1.6. Like a lot, but maybe people view a lot more than they post. Actually, that's probably pretty true from my experience. I'll look at that hack later, Maddie, but about ad views per post, I was going to see how many ads do I see per time I post. Now, I only post on social media about 4 or 5 times a week. I probably see more ads per post than that, actually. So this is a nice social network. Now, it is skewed, and let's look at the stats. The maximum of any customer has 79 ad views per post, which is quite unfortunate. but here's someone who only saw 11, and that's the 99th percentile. So that shows you the statistics. There's even a few people who have hardly seen any ads per post. zero, the first percentile, those lucky people who missed all the ads. Okay, so now it's really in the data set, and the next thing to do is finally look at the cohort analysis. Remember, that was the point. I was going to redo the cohort analysis with listing 5.1. And again, I'm going to go, I should actually make notes in my deck of which version, so I won't be doing this kind of stupid digging in the configurations every time. Let's see. So I want the cohort plot, and I want the, now I really want the one here using AdView proposed. Here we go. So it's version 5, and that's going to be my new cohort plot. Now I guess I'm not going to show you how to do the cohort analysis unless anyone wants to, because we actually went through it earlier in the stream. So it's chapter 5, listing 1, and this is going to be version, shit, what did I just say? Like I said, I gotta save these version numbers. Version 5, sorry, not 7. 7 was the last one. It does get a little overwhelming sometimes working on this book, all the versions of these different listings, but I use the same listing a lot of times, which I think is good for learning it. I mean, and it shows that it's a good listing because I want to show so many different versions. Anyway, how does AdView's per post relate to churn? This should actually do it. Well, there's the answer. You can see it in the little preview. Here's a bigger version of the chart. So AdView's per post actually shows increasing churn. So when earlier we saw that the more ad views, the less churn, it was actually a correlation. And this is more of a causation effect where you're seeing that if you see a lot of ad views per post, it does increase your chance of churning. Now, what about these people here who have zero and they have a somewhat higher churn rate than these people? These people on the zero, and I see this, you know, a lot, these are the people who aren't even using the service. We talked about this in a previous stream. This is typical for a disengaging behavior. And by disengaging behavior, I mean one where the more you do it, the more likely you are to churn, or the less likely to be retained. But it's typical that people who don't use the service at all have a somewhat higher churn rate. And then you see the people who have the lowest of the, who use the service but have a low value on the disengaging metric have the lowest churn rate. But then after that, the more of the disengaging behavior, the worse it is. And in this case, once you get up to more than around like 1.5 ad views per post, you'd actually be better off not using the service. That's what this is saying. These are the people in the bottom cohort, the zeros, who don't even use the service. And this is showing that if you're seeing like more than 2 ads per post, you would be less likely to churn if you weren't even logging in and doing anything. So this is an example, and now I've explained the ratio technique on the simulation and done a full end-to-end demonstration of how you can use a ratio metric to understand churn behavior when it's like a correlation versus causation question. When your correlation effect is showing you a metric reduces churn, but actually you think it might increase churn. So I've got more examples coming up. Let's see, what's next? Okay, well first let's talk about a special case. And now we're getting into like the variations on this technique. Another kind of ratio metric is what I call a percent of total. And that's when the numerator is a part of something and the total is the whole. And I'm illustrating it on this figure from the book with a example of a pretend streaming service. This is like not real data. This is just a completely hand-waving made-up example. But pretend on this streaming service there were action, comedy, drama, and romance movies available. And these lines show the hypothetical event series for one user, maybe over several weeks, who watched a few action, a few comedy, a lot of drama, and then the total events are shown here. So this would be like your total metric, if you made a metric of the total, which we will in a moment. And then this is the percent of total for this particular customer. So 42% drama, 27% romance, 19% action, and 12% comedy. Now, this can be a really useful technique when you have a situation like this, because all of these behaviors are going to be correlated in the sense that a customer who watches a lot on the streaming service is going to watch a lot of everything, usually. Maybe they have some preferred categories, but actually that's what you're getting to at the percent of total, is what are their preferred category without respect to how much do they watch the service overall. So that is the key, like that's what this is showing you, and that's what a percent of total is doing. When all the behaviors are correlated, what's the preferred behavior among the correlated ones? So let's see, the next example, I think we're gonna do, okay, toy metric calculation. Well, the thing is, to do a ratio of a part to the total, I already showed you how to do a ratio, so let's just do some totals. Now, this is showing you a way to calculate a total of other events when you've already calculated the more specific categories. So pretend we have like action views per month, comedy views per month, drama views per month. You calculate the total metric in just the same way, well, almost the same way as for the ratio metric, in that I'm just going to join together these other metrics. So you group them up together. Let's see. Need to get some sleep, Maddie. Yes, you should get some sleep. Thanks for joining me. I enjoyed your stream this afternoon too, when I was able to be on it. Or I guess that was the night for you, but it was my afternoon. So anyway, have a good week, and I'll try to catch your stream during the daytime too. I'm glad you finally streamed on a weekend. If I knew you did that, I'll try to tune in more, because I'm generally not watching streams during the week when I have my day job and all that. Anyway, so this is a toy calculation of a total metric. You literally just join them together and then save it out. So let's look at another example from the simulation. Whoops, I was supposed to go like this. So remember we had likes and dislikes. Now likes and dislikes are actually, you can view them and you can use this approach to them and look at the total percent of, well, you can look at likes and dislikes as a percentage of the times when they gave an opinion. So remember, we had likes are associated with lower churn, but here I'm showing you already likes are also, bad reenactment. Thank you for following, an awesome username, like that. Good one, bad reenactments. So this is the correlation between liking and disliking on the service. And this was the churn behavior for disliking. So we saw that, the more they dislike per month, the less they churn. You're like, why does that make sense? Could it be because it's correlated to liking? Now let's go through the example. So first we're going to, this is gonna be a long multi-step example in the code. First we'll calculate a total metric with listing 7.3. Then I need to re-extract the data set. Now, each time I add a new metric, I need to re-extract the data set to do my analysis. That's just the way it is. Then we'll, this is out of order. First, you do the ratio metric, 7.1, before the data set. So don't do it in the order on this slide if you're following along. And then lastly, we'll look at a new metric cohort for a ratio metric of the percentage of dislikes instead of the total number. Because here we were looking at the total number of dislikes, and let's look at the percentage of dislikes. All right, so to the code, how do we calculate a total metric? There is listing 7.3 from my book, if you want to use it. You can obviously also calculate a total metric just by summing all the events. So when you calculate an individual event per month metric, you select just one event. You could just select all or don't specify the event and you'd get the total. This is a more efficient approach if you've already calculated each individual metric. It's a lot faster because you don't have to recount, you know, all the events. So basically, I don't actually, you know, use the like common table expressions here because this is set up for multiple metrics. So a ratio is always between two. In this case, we're going to select a whole bunch of metrics that are within a list. And then we're gonna sum the result as the total of all those metrics will be the total value. And so it's actually a simpler query than the ratio metric. It's just a simple, it's also an aggregation. So we're still grouping by each metric date and account ID, but it's a simpler aggregation without, you know, different parts. So let's run it. This is gonna be, I have too much stuff open, of course. Let's like close some of these. We're still looking at the total metrics, so let's close these other things we're not doing. All right, finally. So let's go back and we'll run listing 7.3. Let's see. I'll duplicate this one and call it total 7.3. So chapter 7, listing 3. Now this is going to be the version that prints out the details. So like the other metrics in chapter 7, I've got one version which just prints like a user-friendly illustration, and then another version that actually inserts it to the database. So here's my user-friendly illustration version, complete with a little print statement showing you for each account. Let's say account 1, on this date you had, you know, 47 total, etc., etc. So that's the simple illustration of the metric. To insert it into the database, now I'm gonna add the insert flag to the command. I will rerun it. So now my SQL includes the insert into metric name, and I call this metric total opinions. The metric name is the type table, so I don't actually have to store the strings repetitively in the database. Next, I have the insert statement, which will put it into the metric table, and then here's my select and the group by. This is the list that got filled in from the bind variables. So the metric name is in like per month and dislike per month, and oh, it's already done. See, it actually goes pretty quick. If we were calculating this metric from scratch, so to speak, from the raw events, it would be slower, because you'd have to count all the individual events. So I've got a new name in my table, number 26. I don't know how I came up with these numbers, but it should be fine. So total opinions is the new metric. I'll do a quick check, see how many rows I got in the table. Okay. These are all just good sanity checks, and I actually consider these kind of sanity checks, you know, part of data science. You got to make sure that your code actually did what you think it did. So next I'm going to get the new metric into the data set by rerunning the data set listing 7.2. And this one we already saw earlier. This is the flattening the data. Or what do they call it in data camp? They called it sum of logical values that are first computed with a case. I like calling it the data flattening trick, or the data set creation SQL, from a single table of metrics. That's how you create a data set. This was your sum of case that were previously computed. So I've got a new data set file here. And let's see, now I had already opened this, actually. Here's my old stats, don't save, because we're gonna rerun them. And my old data set, so I had add view per post, but none of the other new metrics. So let's see if I got the other new metric. This is my other old data set that I don't need. Here's the new data set that I just saved. Let's see. Actually, no, it's not in the data set. I'm screwing up again. I calculated the total metric. Now I need to calculate the ratio. Sorry, out of order. I'm actually following the order on my mistaken slide. So I added the total to my database. Now I need to calculate my new ratio, which is going to be back in chapter 7. I should have a configuration for my new metric, which is going to be, where is the new ratio? No, it's a version of the ratio metric here. So let's see, I want to do my new ratio metric. Let's see. These don't look like it. Maybe this is it. Version 6, dislike per month, total opinions. Okay, so run version 6 of listing 7.1. So this is going to be my new ratio metric. Let's see, 7 point run, this is ratio. I'm gonna get some proper names in here. So, whoops. 6, I'm just gonna go straight to the insert here. This will be version 7, version 6, double check that, look before I leap. And it's gonna be the insert version. And this should be my new ratio metric, which is gonna be the percentage of all opinions that are dislikes. So going up to the ratio metric calculation, here's the numerator common table expression, dislike per month. And then the denominator is our new metric, total opinions. So this will give us the ratio percentage of dislikes or the percentage of negative opinions. This should be pretty quick too, all right. So that was pretty quick. Now I'm gonna quickly rip through again, sanity checking. I have a new metric, 27 dislike percent. Ooh, hello cat, 11111. Thanks for loving my stream. Are we importing data to SQL to perform the EDA? Actually, I'm exporting the data from SQL to do the EDA. That's my approach. I don't know, people have different approaches. I calculate my metrics and do my feature engineering in the database. Then I export it out and I do my EDA with Python. And if you're not like in on the data science lingo, EDA stands for exploratory data analysis. Let me just put that in there. EDA equals. I actually had to learn that acronym because back when I was educated, I don't think they called it EDA. I just started hearing the people who were interviewing, you know, in my group for internships would be like, oh, here's what I did for EDA. And I'm like, what? So then I learned what EDA means from the younger generation. Anyway, I'm not that old, just kidding. So we've got our new metric, dislike percent, and it's gonna be number 27. So we can actually see how many results we got. A lot, so that's good. All right, now I'm really ready to extract my new metric into my data set. All right, back to the data set, 7.2. Nitty gritty and run. I'll remember this one too. I kind of like Anthemy, you know, house trance songs. I like live music too, by the way. I'm not just an electronic music guy. I like all kinds of music. But you don't find much copyright-free music that's like not electronic. Wait, this is not what I want to do. I want to look at the new data set. I re-extracted the data set, and hopefully now I have a new metric in it. What's taking so long? Where's my data set? I think it's Excel is screwing up. Open the damn data set, Microsoft Excel. I just said I want to check, yes. As usual, opening up in my other screen. So here was the data set that I just created after entering the new metric. And if I scroll over here, you can actually see I have in fact added a dislike percent metric in this column. And you can see it tends to be between 0 and 1, which is what it should be. All right, so now I've got a dislike percent metric in the data set. So that all worked, everything's going as planned. I guess I will quickly run the statistics. I know it's kind of tedious to keep doing this stuff. Turkey invented it. To lo-fi doing data analysis. Lo-fi, that's good. Yeah, I've got a chill hop copyright free stream on Spotify that I use for some of these too. Let's see, where was my stats? Here it is, run stats 5.2. Now I already set it to the right version for the data set two, and we can now look at the statistics of people and their disliking. So let's see, I'm gonna slowly fill out the rows in data set two as we calculate more metrics. So it's a little bit small, I'll make it bigger. So here, the column D is the average. So average of 22% dislikes for these customers. The maximum is one. There are at least some customers who dislike everything. But the 99th percentile and the dislike percent is 0.86% dislikes. So, okay, now we've verified the dislike percent metric is in the data set, and all we need to do is run the cohort analysis to complete that little mini case study. All right, so now which version of the ratio metric is the right one? And as I said, I promise in the future I'm going to come up with a better way of tracking these versions. I want to go back to chapter 5 and get the right cohort plot, really. I want the one for dislike percent, which is number 8. All right, so run the cohorts for version 8. Cohorts is version 5.1, this is 8, and now we'll see how disliking impacts churn. What we've all been waiting for. I don't know if you've been waiting for it, but it's what we're doing. So let's see. First I have to run it, then we can go look at it. Very quick to run, because the data set is already extracted. And we looked at that churn cohort listing 5.1 earlier, so I don't want to like go back into it. All right, this one actually looks similar, a little bit different, but similar to the ad views. Here was ad views. I'm gonna make that smaller now. Sorry, I'm blocking the new result. That's the old result, which was ad views per month. And this is the result for the percentage of dislikes. So here we can see again a similar pattern. The zeros here are the people who don't even use the social network. And they have a higher churn rate than those people who have the lowest percent of dislikes. These are like the best customers here on this metric because they actually are using the service, but they have less than 10% dislikes. Then the more disliking the customer does, the higher the churn. Until when you get up to above around 20% dislikes, then your churn rate is actually higher than if you didn't even use the service at all. Look, if you are in the top cohort with 70% dislikes, that's disliking a lot, then you are at 10% churn rate. And those who don't use the service at all only have 5% churn rate. So I guess those people who don't really like stuff don't last long. But hey, that's how it goes in, you know, SaaS and social networks. You know, customers who aren't happy are going to churn. So that completes a second example of a ratio metric, and it's using a total metric, but it's not the best example of a total metric because in this case there's only two categories, likes and dislikes. Oh, thanks, Hello Cat. What does cohort analysis do? Okay, was that explanation? I guess Hello Cat missed the earlier part of the stream. If you watched the earlier part of the stream, or my stream from like 2 or 3 weeks ago, I went into a lot of detail on the cohort analysis. So, so each cohort is a group of the customers who have a similar value on the metric. So the bottom cohort is like, this is deciles, I think, if there are 10. So each cohort is a decile of the customers according to this one metric. So the bottom cohort has the lowest value of dislike percent. The top cohort is like the top 10% dislikers, if you can say that. I don't know, is that a word, a disliker? And the top 10% of dislikers has a 10% churn rate, whereas these low cohorts, it's actually the second and third deciles in disliking, according to the percentage, are the lowest churn rate. The interesting thing, of course, is it's a story of correlation and causation. This is the cohort analysis for dislike by the number of dislikes, where actually you see more disliking appears good, but it's only because those people use the social network more. And this whole analysis that we did is really just to show you that, you know, more dislikes is actually bad once you separate the correlation effect with something good. Now the next slide, which I started here, is another example from a real case study, which was Broadly. Broadly is a SaaS product, which means software as a service for small businesses. And Broadly helps those small businesses manage their online reviews. It actually, if you've ever gotten a little pop-up like, oh, would you like to review this from a website, it might actually be Broadly that is helping that company ask you for the review. Now, this is the number of positive reviews per month that customers on Broadly got. And you can see that the lowest churn rate is for those customers with more than around 15 positive reviews per month. And once you get up to around 20 positive reviews per month, those are your really healthy customers. And of course, the bottom cohort, those with zero positive reviews per month, have the most churn. Now, what about negative reviews? Now, again, this is real case study data. This is not simulation. This is for negative reviews. So you're like, hey, the more negative reviews per month, they call them detractor. In the business, they don't call them good review, bad review. They call them promoters and detractors. So it's kind of an industry lingo. But so the more detractors per month is also less churn. And you're like, what? How can getting bad reviews make the company want to use Broadly to get the reviews? Well, a quick correlation check shows you that promoter reviews and detractor reviews are correlated. That's a 0.7 correlation. You might not be able to read that tiny little number in the streaming window. So this is real data here, not simulation, and it's showing just the kind of effect that we were just looking at in the simulation. And now here's the real result for the percentage of detractor reviews. Pretty much every customer has a value on this, so you don't have that issue with the zeros. This shows that the more detractor reviews is really worse as a percentage. Actually, the bottom decile in detractors has virtually zero churn, because the zero axis here is zero churn. So this bottom, the people who get the fewest detractor reviews practically don't churn at all from Broadly. And then this top cohort that has more than 25% bad reviews, those customers churn at a really, really high rate. I mean, I can't tell you what the churn rate is. In fact, I don't even remember what the churn rate is, because I did these case studies a while ago. But this shows that the percentage of detractor reviews is really a really negative thing, whereas the number of detractor reviews actually looks positive. So that's why we do all this fancy feature engineering, to give you, you know, that understanding and intuition. Let's see. This is a good song too. There's a really good mix this week. All right, Merck and Cremont featuring Chris Kiss. I might check this one out later too. Now, this is a very visually rich slide, and I'm gonna try to talk you through it. This is a percent of total case study in multiple parts. So more detractor reviews, the higher the cohort churn there is. Yes, but it's if you look at the percentage of detractor reviews, then you see more churn. Just the raw count of detractor reviews is not so bad. Now, this is a real case study data set from Versature, the online voice over IP phone company in Canada. They have four regions for their calls. And I just show them here, region 1, 2, 3, 4, or calls 1, 2, 3, 4. And these plots show you the cohort results for calls in the four regions. So clearly region 1 and region 2 shown up here, the more calls, the lower churn. Region 3, somewhat, yeah, also. Zero calls in region 3, not so good. Then when you get down to more and more calls in region 3, it actually looks a little disengaging. Hard to tell. And region 4, not very strongly correlated at all. Now, like I was saying, customers who use a product a lot use it a lot for everything. So this is showing the correlation heat map between these metrics. And we did correlation heat maps in last week's stream. And that I mentioned it earlier, but I am not going to go into details now. But we went a lot into correlations and correlation matrices, which is what this is. And the top left here shows that calls in the four regions are correlated, which means that the more calls people have in one region, the more calls they tend to have in another region. Now, so this is a classic case where these are all correlated. And if you want to disambiguate some things about them, we need to go to the percentage of total. I'm actually seeing that the music and the chat is blocking this a little bit. Let me make this, whoops, that's not what I wanted to do. No, go back. I want to go here. I want to make this smaller so I can get this part of it from behind my head, hopefully. How's that? A little bit. Yeah, you can make it a little bit bigger. Okay, so now when we look at the percent of totals, which is here in the correlation matrix, first you see something very interesting. I think it's interesting, or if you're into data, it'll be interesting for you. These negative correlations with region 1 show you that the higher percentage of calls in region 1, the lower percentage of calls in the other regions, which is actually perfectly logical, because the 4% of total metrics have to sum up to 1. So the higher percent in one region, the lower percent in the other regions. In this case, region 1 is kind of like the dominant region, so it's negatively correlated with all of the other regions, and the three other regions are only weakly correlated with each other. And you can also see that effect in the regular metrics, too. But anyway, let's go on to the cohorts. The top right shows you the cohort analysis for the percentage of region 1. It actually shows that the optimal value for percentage of region 1 is almost all. The customers who churn the least have almost 100% region 1, but not quite, interestingly. If you have 100% region 1, you're in this cohort, and you have a somewhat higher churn rate. Now for regions 2 and 3, you have this interesting effect where you churn more if you're not using them at all, but the optimal value for regions 2 and 3 is just a little bit, kind of like between, you know, well, these are normalized values, so I don't even know what percents these are, but these are going to be low percentages of regions 2 and 3. Region 4, it turns out, not really related to churn very strongly. It looks a little bit disengaging, meaning there's a subtle but not very strong increase in churn rate the more you use region 4. So this really shows you something pretty insightful, I think, because if you look at regions 1 and 2 and 3 as just the raw metrics, you're like, okay, the more the better. That's all it tells you. Then if you look at these charts on the percentages, you can actually see there's sort of a sweet spot for the customers, that which is mostly region 1, a little bit each of regions 2 and 3. And that is sort of the perfect customer for versus churn, which makes sense because they're taking advantage of all the different parts of the service. So this shows you the power of percentage of total metrics in a case where you have multiple metrics that are all, you know, part of one whole. And I didn't have a good example of that in the simulation. I mean, so anyway, this is why I've got a real data example for percent of total metrics. All right, now let's do the next thing, which is actually we're kind of getting near the end, but for people who are interested in staying around, I'm gonna have one more interesting thing coming up. But first, let's look at what's next here. What's next is a little bit of discussion. Why ratio metrics, and what are your other choices? So I love ratio metrics, mainly because they're interpretable, but there are other kinds of features which will serve the same purpose. The first one is called an interaction term in statistics. I don't know if anyone's heard of that. An interaction term is the multiplication of two metrics to get a new metric. Now, what did I just do with a ratio? Was I did the division of two metrics. And now in statistics, it's common to use a multiplication of two metrics. Multiplication of two metrics is going to be the largest when both metrics are large, or it could be if both metrics are negative and have high magnitude. So that's how you get the highest value. But it's common in statistics, and it can show you some interesting effects and relationships, but they're very hard for humans to understand. Now, I showed you some metrics today that were ratios, and they tend to be units like dollars per call. Now, that's from dividing dollars by calls. So it's dollars over call is dollars per call. If you do an interaction term between calls and dollars, you're multiplying them, and the units become call dollars or something like that. And this is like physics. If anyone's taken physics, you get a lot of multiplicative units. It's hard, it's kind of a mouthful. Say multiplicative units 10 times fast. No, do not. So multiplicative units come up a lot in physics, like kilogram meter and things like that. But if you haven't noticed, they're very unintuitive for humans. On the other, another example we looked at today was ad views per post, which is kind of easy to understand. You're like, okay, how many ads does this person watch per post that they watch? But if you made an interaction term between ad views and posts, it would be ad view posts, which is like, what is an ad view post? It's the multiplication of the number of ads you watched and the number of posts you watched, but you're like, what is it? Ratios, for some reason, division is easier for people to intuit, I find, and I don't know why. I'm not a cognitive psychologist, but I challenge anyone to tell me this is not true. So ad views per post, dollars per call are intuitive, but interaction terms are not. And so that's why I tend to stay away from them in commercial or business-oriented case studies. I mean, interaction terms where you multiply things together can be good if there's a specific meaning in a business context, but it's pretty rare. Now, the other thing you can do, which is similar, is to take differences between normalized scores. That's my second little set of bullet points here. So we've talked a little bit about normalized scores, and we went into details on one of my earlier streams. Good mix today. I gotta say, I'm enjoying this. So literally, in a difference of normalized scores, you literally subtract one score from another. And the difference is high when one score is high and the other is low. So differences between normalized scores is another way to reflect the relative value of two metrics. And they come up naturally in principal component analysis, which was on the stream last week. So not doing PCA today, but there we looked at how differences between normalized scores are generated as part of the PCA analysis. But the thing about them is they're also really hard for humans to understand. The difference between normalized scores, that's great for data scientists and statisticians, but if you go into the marketing department and you're like, here's my metric, which is the normalized score difference between ad views and posts, they'd be like, what? What are you talking about? Normalized scores? What? They wouldn't understand it. But if you go into the marketing department and say, look, too many ad views per post and people churn, and the marketing department will be like, oh my god, we have to show less ads. Or, I don't know about the marketing department, whatever department shows the ads. So again, why do I use ratio metrics for real use cases with, you know, businesses is because people understand them and they know how to take action on them. Yeah, second order interactions, not so fun. I honestly don't even usually get into second order interactions, well, other than through ratios. And I'm not looking at second order interaction, it's complicated, but they're very powerful effects, and that's why we try to use them. So yeah, that's why I use ratio metrics. I mean, for me, they're really the only thing that I use. It's like the only game in town when it comes to understanding, you know, complicated relationships, and you can disambiguate the correlation and causation. So that's actually what I had prepared on the stream today. And what I just wanted to do next is I was thinking about doing a live hack to actually calculate interaction metrics. I actually never did it in the book, but I thought it would be fun to do this. Basically, I'll make a new SQL query that will calculate the interaction, like between ad views and posts, and we'll look at what that looks like as a metric. And hopefully I can hack it and get it into the data set, and then we can compare the interaction term between ad views and posts with the ratio ad views and posts. And to me, this will actually be kind of interesting because I've never done it. You'd think that I would have, having written this book and talked about this a lot. So I'm going to go straight to the code. And so remember, the goal is to make a new metric, which will be the multiplication of two other metrics. Then I'll calculate it, save it in the data set, and do an analysis. So let's go to the code. And I'm going to want to start, I think, from my ratio metric, because now I'm going to make an interaction metric. So let's see, I'm going to save this as a new name. Actually, what number do I have to go up to get a new? I have to give it a number. So it looks like my last metric in the chapter was 7.9. So I will save this as 7.10, just to keep working with the way the code, the book and the code is set up. So this is going to be my interaction metric. And I'm going to try to do this quick and dirty so that no one has to wait too long to see a result. I'm still going to call this, I'm still going to just select numerator and denominator. I'm going to call it the same thing. And now, basically, I want to just insert the multiplication. So I'm just going to do, I guess I can still coalesce both of them. The non-value kind of zero, let's see. So now I don't have to worry about divide by zero. So this can be more, this can be simpler. So this will be my new metric value query. Numerator value, time, from, you know what though? I shouldn't coalesce. I should actually just do an inner join. Because if one or the other metrics is missing, then the, you know, the result is going to be zero anyway. And like I said before about not inserting zeros, into my metric. So I'm just going to not do any coalescing and no checking for zeros. And this, I think, should be my new interaction term query. So that was pretty easy, right? Looked easy. We'll see if I got it right when I try to run it. So now I have a new metric, 7.10, which is going to be my interaction metric. Now I need to make a configuration in the book framework. There's a JSON that configures all these. So I need to enter a new one in chapter 7, a completely new listing. So let's see, so I'll just go down, I have to remember how to do this actually. Well, I start by just writing list 10, that's weird, I thought 9 was the last one. Maybe I didn't really use 9. And I need a name, and it has to match what's in this file. So it's going to be interaction metric. Now I think I want to copy some more stuff ratio metric just to make this easier, because I need some parameters. But oh yeah, add views and posts, perfect. So let's see, back to listing 10. So these will be my defaults for this listing, which is fine. And then I need a default version. This is just rounding out my configurations here. This will be version 1 of listing 10. And do I have to do something special for the inserts? I'm trying to remember. No, I have to make this insert section. Actually, you know what? I should just copy this whole block. That's what I should do. Yeah, so I don't want to have the parameters there. I just want to have this whole block and then close it up, and this will be my insert section. So my default parameters will be add review post, post from others. Now I need to get to a new metric ID. I'm just gonna go up to 51. and I'll call this drum and bass. I didn't know about drum and bass for data science, but I'll just deal with this. It's a little bit distracting. So we'll call this add view post interaction, or interact, right? And if I did everything right, this will actually be all I need to run the new insert. So I'm gonna live dangerously. I'll just start running it, and if it crashes, I'll go back and figure it out later. So I wanna go and make a duplicate, I guess, of my ratio 7:1, and I'll call it interact 7:10. So I'm just gonna see, let's see, chapter 7, listing 10, no version, because this is my first version, and it's an insert. So, yeah, like I said, I'll live dangerously and just see if this worked after one last quick sanity check, staring at it. PyCharm's not telling me any errors, so I'm just gonna try running this. And it should print it out. So it's printed out, that is inserting the metric name 51. We've got add views per month in one CTE, that's common table expression, post per month in the other. And looks like it already worked. So that was actually pretty easy. Thumbs up on getting a metric calculated. Now we have to see if it really worked. As usual, first I'm gonna go check my inserts real quick. All right, I got 51 in there. And let's just, once again, just make sure it actually saved some data, which it did. I think a few less values from the others, if you remember before, but I'm not gonna worry about that now. Probably because I did an inner join. It actually makes sense. There'll be fewer results for this new metric because I did it with an inner join compared to the ratio metric, which had an outer join, so there will be more matching rows. All right, now I need to get metric 51 into my data set. So I'm gonna have to go back and hack my data set listing, which was listing 7:2. I need a new row. I'll just do it after add views per post. And it's gonna be metric ID 51. That's what we just did. And this is add view post interaction. Actually, I'm really excited to do this because I have never really played around with interaction metrics just because the business partners that I work with would never really understand it. So I just never went there. But maybe this will be a really interesting, way to do the analysis. So let's see. Now I do my data set again, 7:2. And it should get that new row if I haven't messed anything up yet. Extracting the data set takes, a noticeable number of seconds. In the meantime, I'm gonna make sure I closed up the old data set. Actually, yeah, I did. All right, so it saved me a new data set and it should have my new metric. If this worked, that'll actually be my fastest live hack ever. I didn't even practice this in advance. So it just goes to show if you have a ratio metric, it's easy enough to make an interaction metric. Okay, now it worked, or it appears to have worked. I have this new column here, which is the add view post interactions. I will try to show it to you. And as you can see, add view post interaction is a big number. Because remember, it's a multiplication. So it's, multiplying two positive numbers, we get a bigger positive number. Now let's quickly do the stats and then we'll do the cohort analysis. All right, so quick, the stats for the data set was, no, that's not it. Where'd it go? Stats. Again, just sanity checking. Here's the new summary stats. Yeah, definitely more like house anthems seem better for streaming than drum and bass. I can kind of just get in the groove, keep moving. So here's my new add view per post interaction summary statistic. The maximum value is a very big number. crazy. All right, so here's my new metric name, add view post interact. The last step in this will be to do a new cohort analysis. And to do that, I need to go back to my listing configuration JSON and enter a new one for chapter 5 listing 1, which is the cohort analysis. Now let's see, I want to use the default data set and just put in a new version all the way at the end. Here, I'll copy, this is like what I'm gonna want, because it's just, I need to specify a new metric in the default dataset. As you can see, there are a lot of versions of cohort analyses in the book. So this one will be, I'll call it version 51 to match the metric. I have to get the metric name exactly right here, so I'm gonna copy paste it, which is a good trick. Don't try typing what you can copy paste. So, how does the interaction of ad views and posts affect churn? Now, what would you expect here? I'm actually just gonna think out loud for a minute. If you have a lot of both ad views and posts, you're going to be kind of a typical customer. You're probably a good customer because you're using the service. If you're very low in ad views or very low in posts, you're probably a bad customer. Back to the more drum and bassy stuff. Anyway, so still think reasoning about the ad view post interaction, you'd kind of expect there's a sweet spot where churn is the lowest. But I'm not really sure. So let's see, how does the interaction between ad views and posts defined by the multiplication affect the churn rate? So now I want to do listing 5.1 version 51 that I just added, and we will see how does the interaction between a good thing and a bad thing result in the churn. Oh no, it didn't work. Maybe I have the wrong data set. It's probably the wrong data set. That's what it is. So I need to collect, I need to go back up here and copy paste something using the right data set. So here's a version using data set 2, and I'll go put that down in my configuration. And then hopefully it'll work. All right, one screw up in this live hack. That's my first screw up in this live hack. That's pretty good if you've seen some of my other live hacks. Let's see, all right, I think it's working. All right, how does the interaction of ad views and posts affect churn? Let's see, huh. Oh no, there it is. It's actually in another one. Okay, that's the old one. So the interaction of ad views and posts actually looks like any other metric in that there's kind of a sweet spot, but you know, I don't think so. It's just the highest is the best. So what that shows is that probably that posting is more engaging than ad views is disengaging. So as you go up higher and higher in ad view post interaction, you're really just a better and better customer because you're using the service a lot. So this actually doesn't really show you any kind of interesting insight or sweet spot. But anyway, I showed you how you can calculate an interaction term with the fighting churn from data code and use it in your own data. So if you're someone who knows what this is, you know, who knows about interaction terms, and you're like, hey, how come there's no interactions in the book Fighting Churn with Data? Here it is. Now you know. I showed you the new listing that I just kind of hacked together from the ratio metric. All I did was use a multiplication instead of a division. And that's how you get interaction terms. So that was the live hack component of this stream. And I think I'm gonna wrap it up. So what else is there? I say stick with ratio metrics for these kinds of advanced churn analysis cases. So I think this is pretty much the end. The summary for today's stream is here. Thank you for everyone who stuck it out with me through the live hack. So fighting churn is about targeted interventions, improvements, engagement with your customers, like support by training them or reaching out to them, and also giving a good pricing plan. Metrics summarize customers' events and subscriptions, and metric cohorts show how churn relates to behavior in a way that's easy to understand and act on. So we didn't use any AI or machine learning today, but we are going to in future streams. Ratio metrics are formed by dividing one metric by another. And we also just looked at a case of an interaction metric, which is multiplying one metric by another. Now, ratio metrics are really cool because they disentangle the relationship between causation and correlation. When you have two different metrics, which are both related to churn, but perhaps in a different way. So ratio metrics are really, really useful. And they help your machine learning too. I'll show you in later streams that not only are these interpretable and actionable, but they improve your accuracy if you're doing machine learning, which is of course what a lot of data scientists are interested in. So percent of total metrics were a special case of ratios, which we looked at. And ratios are easily understood by humans, in contrast to the alternatives, which are things like interaction terms and normalized scores. So that's it. In case you didn't know, this is my new year, new schedule. I'm on 2 p.m. Pacific time on Saturdays. I'm only doing one day per week now because I'm working on a new project with Manning, which will be a live churn analysis project where you can download a real data set and do your own churn analysis. Because my book only uses a simulated data set, but this project will have a real data set that you can play with. Anyway, that's why I'm not streaming more. I was streaming 2 days a week last year, but it's too much while I'm working on this project. So, also, if you miss any of my streams and you prefer YouTube, you can find all my old streams on YouTube now. Just search for Fighting Churn with Data Science. That's my YouTube stream name. And of course, if you want to really go in depth, you can get the book that explains all this. This is a coupon you can use from my publisher on my publisher's website, manning.com/books/fighting-churn-with-data. I don't know why I said that. You can read. TwitGold40 is the discount code. And thank you for joining me, everyone who lasted this long. I know Maddie left. Lily probably left a while ago. Scott, I don't know if you're still there. Or hello, Kat. Everyone who participated in today's stream, I really appreciate the interaction and hearing from you about your questions and comments. So if you want to connect with me on LinkedIn, please reach out. Just if you want to connect with me on LinkedIn, just say you watched my stream or you care about churn or anything. I don't connect to people on LinkedIn who just say like, I am interested in connecting with you or, you know, please be my connection. But if you give me any indication that you care about churn or the book, I will happily connect with you on LinkedIn. Also, please follow me on Twitter for updates about subscriptions, data science, churn analysis, all that kind of stuff. I don't really tweet personal stuff. No politics, no cat pictures, just data, subscription business, and stuff like that. And yeah, well, next week will be my next stream. Saturday, February 6th, we will continue with advanced metrics. So this was the first and most important area of advanced customer metrics, but there are a few subjects that I'll go into next time. So let's see, few people still left out there. Does anyone want to like do a raid if there's any other data science or cool streams? I don't know, I can do a quick check if any of my favorite streamers are live. Let me just see. I'm actually a really picky stream viewer, I've found. Like, if it's kind of just like coding in a language that I don't really know, I usually am not that into it. I also stream, you know, music a lot. Sophie Tucker, if you know them, have a really awesome stream. Let's see, are any of my favorite streamers live? Let's see. None of the really good data science streamers are live. Maddie Two Shoes' stream is pretty good, but it's really late for him. And yeah, none of my favorite music streamers are live either. So I'm just gonna let you all folks go do your own thing. We're not gonna do a raid because there's no one. I don't know. I'm not gonna raid some random stream just for the heck of it. So have a good rest of your Saturday, everyone out there. Thank you so much for joining me today. This was one of my favorite subjects, so I'm glad the stream was fun. And take care. Please come back next week. And yeah, peace. I'm out.